The system in the early days was viewed as kind of a glorified vocational system, and it did come from a vocational base, but of course it, in time, expanded so much beyond those basics.
But we had to show the legislature that we could do more, because they too had the assumption that we were just vocational, so we just had to prove ourselves, and I think we did.
I was an integral part of the design for the 80s, the original design. I led some groups to the robotics lab at Carnegie Mellon and took a group to GE in Detroit and looked at their training program. And we had people doing microelectronics and robotics. Its intent totally was to get us current with technology, which we were beginning to lag behind. We never had enough equipment money to stay current.
Design for the 80s. Let each of the 16 colleges come up with an idea as to what they would be best for. And I'm sure I can't remember them all, but Piedmont Robotics, that was big in the 80s. So they came up with a proposal to do robotics, which they got funds for. And a student made a robot that would walk and talk on the table. And so we decided to use that as an introduction to design for the 80s to the Budget Control Board for our budget presentation. Well, the robot walked down to the end of the table, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, blah, 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 we're here today, so forth and so on. Well, it turned too sharp, it fell off on the floor. Of course, everybody jumped to pick Mr. Robot up, but it made a point. We had a 18-wheeler that had the CNC machines where you type in the computer what you want this machine to cut out. And we would take that around the state and show it to existing industry, new industry. And we had it parked on the state house grounds for a couple of days just to let the members come out and see that we were high tech, that we did know what we were doing. And so we started, you know, getting a little respect at the state house after showing them that we could do things other than what they thought we were doing. One of the reasons that Michelin came in to South Carolina was designed for the 80s in that we would custom make a program that just fit like a tailor-made suit.
You just couldn't find people out there every day that knew how to do the kinds of technical jobs. South Carolina said, we're going to support manufacturing. We're going to prepare the people with the training to be able to do these things.
I had 17 bosses, because I had my boss here and then I had the colleges, and that was tough. One of the main parts of our budget is money for equipment, because as you know, computers change daily, and that is one heck of an expense for our 16 colleges. And 1 year, we were able to get, I think it was like $1 million in equipment, because we hadn't gotten any equipment in so many years. Rembert Dennis was chairman of finance at that time, and there was an office down there of local government, and it was run by Woody Brooks. And Woody Brooks shelled out the money for infrastructure in the counties, so he was very well liked, plus the fact that his office made the best Bloody Mary in the State House. And I went in there one morning to see Woody, not to get a Bloody Mary, but Rembert Dennis, Senator Gressett, Ed Salevey, and Jack Lindsay were in there having their morning coffee. And I said, excuse me, gentlemen, I'll be back. And Senator Dennis said, wait a minute, son, I need to see you. He said, I see in the House budget where you got a little money for equipment. He said, I need to borrow that money so we can give state employees a raise this year. He said, now you can fight me on the floor of the Senate, but I think I can beat you. I said, Senator, I'm not gonna fight you anywhere. No way. And of course, Lindsay said, good answer, boy, good answer. The next year, this is when we went before the Budget and Control Board to make our budget presentation. Before we even got started, Rembert Dennis stood up and said, gentlemen, these folks helped us out last year. I want to help them out. I'd like to propose $1.5 million for their equipment program. They need it badly. I had not said a word to him the whole session about that money. He remembered it. And that's the type of people we were dealing with back then. They were gentlemen. They looked out for the state. They looked out for themselves, but they most looked out for the state of South Carolina. We called it a resume. In that resume, you had to know what they each one of them drank, what sport they played, if they liked golf, if they liked football, or what have you. We had at one time during December, the off season, a golf tournament down in Charleston. Henry Brown was chairman of Ways and Means then, and he would pick a team, and I was lucky to be chosen several times. Henry would ride around on a golf course watching his team play, and he would come up behind you and say, Zobel, you know that money you need in the budget? Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. You better make this putt. I mean, you talk about pressure. It was all in fun, but still, you knew that he needed your help, and we needed his help. So it's a game people play.
Part of the responsibility of the president of the system is to get as much public exposure as you can, and you typically do that, at least in my judgment, you do that through the chief executive. They have to be involved in the community, they have to be involved in manufacturing, medical services, they just have to be everywhere and create the kind of image then that makes it easy for the General Assembly to provide money for the system. That was my view of the major role I had. And to develop the kind of relationship with the legislature so that they would be responsive not only to budgets, but other needs the system might have. We got the college transfer program placed in every institution, which makes life easier today for a lot of South Carolinians who don't have the money to go 4 years to a senior institution to get the first 2 years and transfer.
The Associate Arts and Associate in Science was a real change up through the late 1980s, where there were a number of technical colleges in which students could take, for example, English 101 at one technical college and then would transfer to a senior institution. They took that course here at Horry Georgetown Tech, who would not transfer. So we had a caste system within the technical colleges. All students were not treated the same regardless of having taken the same course.
We got the Commission on Higher Education to agree that all of the technical colleges should have the college transfer program. There was some opposition to that initially from the University of South Carolina and from a couple of other smaller colleges who feared that we would take enrollment away from them. My experience in Florida, based on research that had been done there, for every freshman you took away, you gave back 1.5 juniors. And because of the age of the student typically entering the technical college system, these students were much more mature, much more determined, and made better grades in their junior year than the group that started at the university or the senior college. People didn't want to buy into that, but we kept saying that. And I think that's turned out to be the case. That was a pretty significant accomplishment because of the university's opposition to what we were doing. I went to see Jim Holderman, the president of the University of South Carolina, to explain to him what we were doing and why we were doing it. And he, at that time, was in the midst of his own problems, getting bad publicity, rumors, that sort of thing. And I said as directly as I knew how, you and I don't need to fight over this issue on the TV every night, but I want you to know I'm intellectually and emotionally prepared to do that if it comes to that. But I think it's in your best interest that you let somebody else do that from the university. His immediate response was, why don't we do something different, Jim? Why don't we merge the technical college system with the University of South Carolina? We would rule higher education in the state. Nobody could touch us politically. We would be dynamite. And I asked him a few questions, and the questions came back in such a way that we would end up being subservient in every respect. Although he promised me I would be the chancellor, he said our chairman of the state board would be on their board. He was politically pretty savvy, and this was what he was trying to do. And I didn't want to offend him at the very first meeting, so I said, well, let me think about that and talk to some of our people. And then I went back to him a second time and told him, no, we weren't interested in that. I said, we ought not turn this into a political issue. This ought to be looked at on its merits and not from a political perspective. And he said, well, I'll do that. In the meantime, we put together a plan of work where every member of the General Assembly had been approached either in a small meeting or individually, and told about this effort on our part and what we were planning to do and why, and wanted their support. Not everybody pledged their support, but an overwhelming majority did. I got a call that afternoon before the next morning's meeting. Fred Shaheen said, "We have three letters of opposition." Fred said, "Can you get them to withdraw the letter?" I said, "I doubt it. But you turn your fax machine on and you fill it with paper." We called every president that afternoon. And the next morning, the chairman called the meeting to order. And he said, "We have expressions of interest from some members of the General Assembly. We're going to take a 15-minute recess for you to read those letters." It was something like 40 letters of support and three against it. And when the letters were distributed, the chancellor of the two-year system and the provost looked at each other like, "Whoa, how did this happen? They're only supposed to be three letters here." There were a lot of people who feared that this would take us away from the technical emphasis and career education emphasis. That has not been the case at all. Their fears were unfounded, and I knew that would happen. I mean, that we're all about job creation, but at the same time, there are people who can't afford the tuition at Carolina and other institutions of higher learning that need an opportunity locally before they transfer. It was all, in my mind, all about affordability, and in some cases, marginal students who could be brought up to par with freshmen and sophomore students at the universities. It was a wonderful thing, and that's, I think, the best thing that happened during my administration.
The system has positively impacted the quality of life in South Carolina. After 1972, when Nixon signed the law that authorized the Environmental Protection Agency, through the 70s and into the early 80s, they wrote all the regulations. Well, all of a sudden, people had to catch up. So how do you catch up to be able to keep manufacturing support to keep all of these services going? Well, the technical college system stepped up at Sumter, and they formed the Water Quality Institute. By 1986, we saw that it just wasn't water. It was, how do you handle hazardous waste properly? How do you meet the regulations, but also manufacture safely? Well, we changed the name to the South Carolina Environmental Training Center. And we added all of these features in training. It was a magnet for industry would send people there, let people come off the job, train them to take care of all of these emerging regulatory needs and trends. At Aiken Technical College, there are tremendous environmental related programs in radiation control, radon. We actually did some work with asbestos and things like that. So the system has had a tremendous influence on and support of environmental quality, thus the quality of life in South Carolina.
One of the first lessons that I learned very early on when I was on Trident's board was that we train and graduate the highest number of minority students in anywhere in the state. I would say that's probably been true for the time period that I've been involved in the system since 82. That was the one thing that struck me about walking through Trident's campus, was the number of black kids that I saw walking across campus, and I thought, wow, this is interesting. In 1958, when I left here, schools were still segregated. The society was still segregated. My dream as a child walking down Main Street was to be able to go in the S&S cafeteria because they had that big old fish tank in the window. And the only reason I wanted to go is because I wanted to see what it looked like from the other side. When I go to graduation now, I'm still struck by the number of minority students who come across the stage and the degrees that they're getting. I'm always mentally cataloging what areas they're studying in.
If you really want to know how good this system is, get out of it. Live in another state, work in their education system, then come back. Then you'll much better appreciate what's here. When I looked for a presidency, there were none available at the time in South Carolina. I ended up going to Bangor, Maine. And when I got to Maine, I found out they had no idea what South Carolina was doing. They really didn't know. and I worked with the economic development people up there, and I said, look, there's a strategy going on in the South that you are totally unaware of, in which they are trying to bring business in very successfully into the state where they're training people to work in those businesses. As a result of that, I got a number of people from Maine to come to South Carolina to meet with the leaders of what was then the State Board for Development, and also with the technical college system leadership. And I remember flying down with them and them saying, I don't know why in the world we're going to South Carolina. The Northeastern pride in business is phenomenal. And on the way back, I couldn't get those guys to shut up. They talked the entire time about what they were going to do when they got back to Maine.
People from all over the country would come here and visit to look at our pre-employment special schools program, we called it back then, and couldn't go home and implement it because they were restricted somehow in their legislation and couldn't get it changed because there were other interests competing for that kind of work. So we didn't have any difficulty explaining what we were doing to other people because nobody else could emulate, which was kind of fascinating.
But I remember one occasion we had a company come to the state of South Carolina wanting to locate here. And we showed them what we had. We showed them where we could do that training, where we could locate them, things of this nature. We even got a state plane and took them to North Carolina because they wanted to go and look at North Carolina. They came back after a day with folks in North Carolina, and the best words in the world said, let's go home to South Carolina. And they picked South Carolina.